Thank you so much. Good afternoon. It's a true honor to be here today. Thank you, Secretary General and Annamaria Tarantola for this invitation. I have given many presentations, but I've never been as nervous as I am today. I'm truly honored to be invited to present at this conference. I have prepared a PowerPoint presentation that we'll show in a moment. If we can just go to the first slide of the presentation, I would like to link first to the presentation that were done in the past. And if we can move the presentation, please. And we have heard last week and today as well, this importance of moving toward this integral ecology for a human economy as in Laudato Si. And it's very important in that movement to talk about sustainable growth, the green economy, technology that works at the service of people. Of course, these are all important concepts, and I would like to say they are economic concepts. As I teach in my Economics 101 class, we have limited resources and we have to use them well. And this is so much present as well in the words of Pope Francis and in Laudato Si as well. I would like to say, as Pope Francis has mentioned, that the crisis gives us an opportunity to discuss, and I would like to say, reimagine our future. I want to use the word reimagine to give us the courage as well to change course and to be very ambitious as we think and look forward at how we can rebuild. And my message today is that we also need to add to that education, to that training, something specific, which I'm going to call financial training, financial education. In the next slide, I'm going to already summarize the main message of my presentation, which is that financial training is necessary to meet the global challenges that we have heard in these 2 days, and also to change the current statistics. I'm going to show you a little bit of data today to show that in our reimagining of the future, we need to add change in those statistics as well. And the message is we need to invest in people, we need to invest for the future. And I want to mention 2 particularly important groups we need to invest in, which are women and the young. And that financial training plays a decisive role in promoting the centrality of the human people, of the human being, of that culture of care. If I had given this talk maybe 5 or so years ago, I would not have been able to show you some of the data. And now we have much more statistics available to show how important, for example, the financial training is. But in particular, if we want to promote financial inclusion, and let me say the word financial resilience now as well, we need that financial training. We need to have not just general knowledge, but we also need people to have a specific knowledge, financial literacy. To paraphrase something that was said before, we need a manual, the manual as well, that explains to people how the markets work, how in particularly how the financial market works. In the next slide, I'm going to give you the number that I would like all of you to remember. If there is a message to take away from my presentation today, it's this one number. It's a striking statistic. It's the number of people who have basic financial literacy in the world. And this number will come up again and again. So let me explain it in more detail. In the next graph, I'm going to show you the proportion of people who are financially literate. What do I mean by that? Several years ago, in collaboration with the World Bank and with the support of the S&P 500 Financial Services and Gallup, we were able to basically have a survey of the basic financial knowledge across countries. So how do you measure financial literacy? I could speak probably an entire day about these measurement issues, but what we have assessed here is whether people have a basic understanding of the functioning of financial markets, whether they know the concept at the basis of every financial decisions. I'm talking about the working of interest rate, interest compounding, inflation, and risk diversifications. So those basic concepts are at the basis of the working of the economy. And what we found is so few people have this basic knowledge. What you see in this graph in the darker colors are the countries where at least more than half, 55% of the population have this very, very basic knowledge. And as you can see, so few of those countries we can picture in a dark blue. Financial literacy is lacking, and it's lacking not just in the most developed countries, it's also lacking in countries with well-developed financial markets. In the next slide, I would like to tell you that when we look at the specific topics that we have considered, and again, this is the ABC of finance and economics, we found that even countries belonging to the G7, the major advanced economies, and compare them with the country I report them in here in orange, the BRICS country. First of all, even in countries belonging to the G7, the financial literacy is not very high, but where there is a stark difference between, for example, the BRICS versus the G7 countries is in understanding and knowledge of risk and risk diversification. But financial markets deal exactly with that. They manage risk, and people have to understand what risk is and how to diversify, reduce risk away. And this is, of course, of primal importance in a moment in which we are dealing with the risk of this pandemic. Just to remind you how important these concepts are. In the next slide, I'm going to show you that even in countries with the most developed financial market, like the US, the knowledge is indeed very low. And here is another kind of one third I want to remind you, which is even in the US, only one third of the population up to the age of 50, basically when we have made many of the most important financial decisions, only that small proportion has a knowledge of the financial market, even though I can assure you the behavior of the stock market and statistics about the stock market are mentioned every day in the news, yet people have a very, very limited understanding of this concept, of this basic principle. And I have to say, age and experience are not good teachers. That knowledge, financial knowledge, increases very, very slowly with age. And probably people do not learn about this concept just by watching the world around them. And in the next slide, I'm also going to show you that not only this knowledge is low, but it's particularly low among some groups. And I want to focus on one particularly important group, also because it's so large, women. Not just financial literacy is low, but it is particularly low among women. And this is the case in almost every country. And the striking finding here is that women answer in the same way to the financial literacy questions around the world. This is a problem because implicitly, it makes women more fragile, less able to participate to the economy, less able to participate to the financial markets. In the next slide, I also want to tell you about a new source of data. And thanks to the OECD, since 2012, we can also measure financial literacy among the young, among 15 years old. And this is because financial literacy has been added to the topic that the Program for an International Student Assessment measure for these young people around the world. So this is, first of all, showing that financial literacy has become an essential skills that everyone needs to participate to society. These are the topic measured by the PISA OECD assessment. And I was very fortunate and honored to lead the groups of experts we designed those questions. And what we found is that many young people do not have this basic skill, even though they are on the cusp of making a very important decision, which is whether or not to continue to invest in education. And what the data already indicates is that when we look at financial literacy, the small group of students who are financially literate are disproportionately already the privileged student, the one coming from high income, high education, and high education parents. So that lack of knowledge starts very early, and it is also very unequally distributed among the young. And we already start seeing gender difference in financial literacy at this age. The reason why I'm telling you this and I highlighted this data, as the next slide indicate, is that financial literacy matters. So for example, it matters for financial inclusions. It is those who have a higher financial literacy that are more able to participate to formal markets like the banking system, formal credit, and formal savings. And so many people participate today in the market without having an understanding of what markets do and the basic concept behind the important financial decisions. And in the next slide as well, I'm going to show you that the most recent data that we have collected during the pandemic shows that financial literacy has acted like a shield to protect people against shock. The Financial Education Committee in Italy that I chair has collected data during the pandemic during the month of June. And we have actually seen, and the data shows, that financial literacy now is even more important and can really help people become more financially resilient. I don't know if you see it, but I have a pin attached to my jacket. And it is because it says that October is financial literacy month. We have dedicated a month to financial literacy because we want to raise awareness of this very important topic in Italy at this time. In the next slide, I'm also going to show you that financial literacy is also very important as we look at wealth inequalities. People who understand and participate to the financial market and take advantage to the opportunities offered by financial market are better able to grow their wealth, are better able, for example, to invest in high return asset. But this is responsible also to the increase in wealth inequality that we see, for example, in the US, according to our studies, as many as from 30 to 40% of the wealth inequality is now is attributed or can to be attributed to difference in financial knowledge. So we really need to get access to that manual, to that knowledge that allows people to better take advantage. And if you don't want to refer to wealth or financial wealth in developing countries, you know, we have looked at informal markets and we have seen the critical importance of financial literacy for people to become more financially resilient and also to participate more to the financial market. In the next slide, I want to therefore take this data to say it's very important to build a more financially resilient society. And to do so, we need to include and have policymakers focus as well on the financial well-being of people. And we need to add an indicator, not just as education, but also financial education among this indicator of well-being. In this way, we can probably aim to be and achieve a more inclusive society. In the next slide, what I also want to say, you know, we have learned about how can therefore be effective in making financial literacy more available to people. And I want to mention some of the programs that have proven effective in order to make people more financially literate. We need financial literacy in school, starting very early in elementary school. And I think we need to follow the example of the countries that have made financial training mandatory. Many countries have now made financial education mandatory in school. And I think it is a very, very important step to make sure there is access to financial literacy to everybody, not just to the children of the high education parents. But that's not enough. We also need to have financial education in the workplace, financial education in the community where people go to learn. And just to conclude, a lot of people have asked me, what is next slide? Have asked me, you know, what is important and who are the groups that we need in particular to target? And I want to mention girl and women as a very important group to target. Very recently in Italy, a report from Caritas told us what is that the face of poverty today is the face of a woman with children. And so we need to also consider this, and we need to empower women so they are much less, they are much more financially resilient. Just in my very last slide, I want to mention the definition of financial literacy that I prefer. A lot of people have asked me, how do you define financial literacy? And I want to define it in the simplest way, which is, financial literacy is a vision for the future. And the question we should all ask is, but which future do we want to build? Thank you very much.